Pleasure to introduce Donald Lopez, Arthur E. Link Distinguished University Professor at the University of Michigan. Professor Lopez is a leader in the field of Buddhist studies, but on a more personal level, he was also my doctoral advisor. And thankfully, too, he continues to be my postdoctoral advisor with apparently infinite patience for my steady stream of phone calls and emails. Back in 1993, when I chose to work with Don, I was initially drawn by two aspects of his work: his ability to raise and hold open the big questions of religious studies. This, combined with a truly remarkable eye for what's beautiful and most telling about Buddhism. I remember one of the first times I was in his office when I saw he had hung two pictures on the back wall. One, if my memory serves me correct, was a painting of Manjushri, the Bodhisattva of wisdom, who holds one book, a book in one hand and wields the sharp sword of insight in the other. But hanging above this in a place of honor, according to the Tibetan tradition, was not a picture of some other Buddha or even a great lama, but a framed photograph of the Mahasattva of the West, Sigmund Freud. Here in his office, I discovered the two sides of Don that had drawn me to him, but they were tied together in this mischievous display by something that I hadn't expected, a wonderfully playful sense of humor. In Don's lectures over the past week, we've witnessed all of these aspects at work. He's consistently challenged our comfortable assumptions, even as he has dazzled us with carefully selected gems of Buddhist doctrine, all set within his lively and often humorous prose. Perhaps we might even take the two lectures Don delivered last week as embodying the first aspect of his thought that originally drew my attention. With a methodological acuity that surely challenged everyone present, Don exposed the contradictions and the problematic histories that lie behind the West's conceptions of a purified or scientific Buddhism. But this week, we're seeing Don's other aspect, his remarkable appreciation for the traditions he studies. In yesterday's talk, he began to explore how we might let Buddhism speak on its own terms. Of course, such a project inevitably returns us to our own room full of mirrors. And ultimately, it may well be an impossible task. Nonetheless, Don's talk yesterday seemed to call on us to endeavor in this direction, to keep trying to glimpse the unexpected and perhaps even valuable alternative perspectives that Buddhism offers. Hearing Don's beautifully formulated talks over the past week and considering his subtle arguments, I'm now convinced more than ever that the original reasons for my wanting to study with him some 15 years ago remain as compelling as ever. I'm sure we're all looking forward to hearing Don's final offering in this stimulating series of lectures. So without any further ado, I invite Don.
Thank you, Jake. In his famous essay entitled The Two Cultures, first delivered as the Reed Lecture at Cambridge in 1959, C.P. Snow decried the seemingly unbridgeable gap between the sciences and the humanities. Snow observed that in London, the inhabitants of Burlington House, which is home to five scientific learned societies, including the Royal Astronomical Society, on the one hand, and those of Chelsea, apparently a hotbed of humanists, on the other, had so little in common that in going the 3 miles from Westminster to Chelsea, in his words, one might have crossed an ocean. And when one did in fact cross the ocean and come to America, one found a similar chasm between the inhabitants of MIT and the denizens of Greenwich Village. Indeed, the humanities types of Greenwich Village, in Snow's words, would have, quote, about as much communication with MIT as though the scientists spoke nothing but Tibetan. 50 years later, humanities scholars have entered the laboratory where they're translating the words of Tibetan lamas for scientists conducting experiments. What hath God wrought? As I noted in the first lecture, in the long history of the discourse of Buddhism and science, what has been meant by Buddhism has changed over the decades. In the beginning, Buddhism was the original Buddhism, postulated by European Orientalists, a Buddhism that had then came to be identified with the Theravada tradition of Sri Lanka and Southeast Asia, or at least with its Pali canon. In the period after the Second World War, Buddhism became Zen, especially as represented by D.T. Suzuki. During the 1960s and 70s, Buddhism was often the Madhyamaka philosophy of Nagarjuna and his doctrine of emptiness. Over the past two decades, the Buddhism in the dialogue with science has largely been Tibetan Buddhism, a form of Buddhism that just a century ago was regarded as such a degenerate form of superstition that it did not deserve the name Buddhism, but was referred to instead as Lamaism. A century later, the mysterious Grand Lama of Lhasa, the Dalai Lama himself, holds annual seminars with some of the leading scientists in the world. The referent of science has also changed. Although quantum physics and cosmology still capture attention in some quarters, the greatest energy is being directed toward neuroscience and especially research on meditation. There are a host of questions to be considered surrounding this newest domain of Buddhism and science. Rather than pointing to affinities between particular Buddhist doctrines and particular scientific theories, research on meditation has sought to calculate the physiological and neurological effects of Buddhist meditation. Such research would seem to introduce a welcome empirical element to the Buddhism and science discourse. The assertions being made in this domain are qualitatively different from the assertion that the Buddha understood the theory of relativity. The claim here is that Buddhist meditation works. However, in order to understand the laboratory findings, such a claim requires that one first identify what is Buddhist about this meditation, describe what the term meditation encompasses in this case, and perhaps most difficult of all, explain what works means, especially in the context of the exalted goals that have traditionally been ascribed to Buddhist practice. Last year, the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, a branch of the Department of Health and Human Services, published a report on meditation at the request of the National Center for Complementary and Alternative Medicine. The purpose of this report was to review and synthesize the state of research on a variety of meditative practices by examining 813 previous studies on meditation. It is a long report, 473 pages in length, and it concludes with this quote. The field of research on meditation practices and their therapeutic application is beset with uncertainty. The therapeutic effects of meditation practices cannot be established based on the current literature. Further research needs to be directed toward the ways in which meditation may be defined, with specific attention to the kinds of definitions that are created. A clear conceptual definition of meditation is required, and operational definitions should be developed. The lack of high-quality evidence highlights the need for greater care in choosing and describing the interventions, controls, populations, and outcomes under study so that research results may be compared and the effects of meditation practices estimated with greater reliability and validity. Firm conclusions on the effects of meditation practices in healthcare cannot be drawn based on the available evidence. It is imperative that future studies on meditation practices be rigorous in design, execution, analysis, and the reporting of results. Such a conclusion is surely cautionary. However, perhaps more interesting are the kinds of studies one finds surveyed in the report. Meditation has been tested for its benefits for weight loss, for lowering blood pressure, for lowering cholesterol, and for reducing substance abuse. That is, meditation is regarded in these studies as a therapy for stress reduction. Indeed, one of the forms of meditation examined in the federal study is MBSR, mindfulness-based stress reduction. But is stress reduction a traditional goal of Buddhist meditation? Perhaps one might think of nirvana as the ultimate state of stress reduction, the complete cessation of all physical and mental processes. We recall then that in Beyond the Pleasure Principle, Freud used the term Nirvana Principle to refer to the tendency of the psyche to reduce the quantity of internal and external excitation as much as possible, even down to zero. Elsewhere, Freud linked the Nirvana Principle to the death instinct. A glimpse at any number of forms of Buddhist meditation, however, suggests that stress reduction is often not the aim. We might consider one of the most common teachings of the Nyingma sect of Tibetan Buddhism, called the Four Ways of Turning the Mind Away from Samsara. These are the so-called preliminary practices, ngundro, meditations that must be completed in order to receive tantric initiation. The first of these is on the rarity of human birth, how, among the many beings that populate the six realms of rebirth, those reborn as humans with access to the Buddha's teachings are incredibly rare. Among the many metaphors for the difficulty of attaining such a human birth, one of the most famous is that of a single blind tortoise swimming in a vast ocean, surfacing for air once every century. On the surface of that ocean floats a single golden yolk. It is rarer, said the Buddha, to be reborn as a human with the opportunity to practice the Dharma than it is for the tortoise to surface for its centennial breath with its head through the opening in that golden yolk. The second meditation is on the certainty of death and the uncertainty of the time of death, the recognition that one will definitely die, yet the time of death remaining utterly indefinite. If this is the case, if one cannot say with certainty which will come first, the next moment or the next lifetime, what pleasure is to be found in the world? This is the subject of much Buddhist poetry. For example, do those who fall to earth from a mountain peak find happiness in space as they rush to destruction? If we constantly race toward death from the time of birth, how can beings find happiness in the time in between? The third of the preliminary practices is to meditate on the workings of the law of karma, discussed yesterday, how negative deeds done in the past will always ripen as suffering, and that over a beginningless cycle of rebirth, each of us has committed countless crimes. The prospect of eternal suffering lies ahead. And what are these sufferings? The fourth and final meditation is on the faults of samsara, visualizing in detail the tortures of the eight hot hells and the eight cold hells, the four neighboring hells and the various trifling hells, the horrible hunger and thirst suffered by ghosts, the sufferings of animals, the sufferings of humans that we know so well, and even the sufferings of gods. For in Buddhism, the gods also suffer. It is said that certain signs attend the death of a god in heaven. His grand throne becomes uncomfortable. He begins to perspire. The garlands of flowers around his neck begin to wilt. His servants seem reluctant to approach. His palace becomes dusty. At that moment, it is said that the god has a vision of his next lifetime, and because a god will inevitably be reborn in a lower realm, because gods squander their time in heaven intoxicated by pleasure, this is said to be the most intense suffering in the entire cycle of rebirth. This is the briefest of descriptions of a central topic in Buddhist meditation, one that is often presented in the most gruesome detail. The goal of such meditation is to cause one to regard this life as a prisoner regards his or her prison, to cause one to strive to escape from this world with the urgency that a person whose hair is on fire seeks to douse the flames. The goal of such meditation, in other words, is stress induction. This stress is the result of a profound dissatisfaction with the world, a dissatisfaction that is regarded as an essential prerequisite for any progress on the Buddhist path. With that prerequisite in place, the Buddhist practitioner embarks on a path intended not to reduce stress or lower cholesterol, but to uproot the more fundamental forms of suffering. These include what are referred to as the sufferings of pain. In the case of humans, these include birth, aging, sickness, death. losing friends, gaining enemies, not encountering what you want, and encountering what you don't want. And the sufferings of pain are only the most overt. The Buddha also spoke of what he called the sufferings of change. These, in fact, are feelings of pleasure, which by their very nature will eventually turn into pain. The claim here is that pleasure and pain are fundamentally different, that pain remains painful unless something is done to alleviate it, while pleasure will naturally turn into pain. The warmth of the sun on one's back will eventually begin to burn. The satisfaction of savoring a delicious meal will turn to nausea if one continues eating. The most subtle form of suffering of all is one of which the unenlightened are said to be oblivious, and it is that our minds and bodies are so conditioned that we are always subject to suffering in the next moment. This is because our existence depends on causes and conditions over which we have no control. Karma again. If the Buddha had sought to alleviate only the most superficial suffering, then endowed with both omniscience and deep compassion for all sentient beings, he would have taught something more compatible with modern science. Rather than teaching something that, to the ears of some, sounds vaguely like the theory of relativity, the Buddha would have provided a cure for suffering as science understands it. He would have set forth the Indoor Plumbing Sutra and the Lotus of Good Dental Hygiene, but he did not. Instead, he spoke of a more subtle suffering, one that for the unenlightened lies unnoticed like a wisp of wool in the palm of the hand, but that for the enlightened can never be ignored like a wisp of wool in the eye. Indeed, some Buddhist thinkers have claimed that the teachings of the Buddha are so profound that they will always remain beyond anything that science can understand. The Chinese monk Taishu wrote in 1928, quote, "The reality of the Buddhist doctrine is only to be grasped by those who are in the sphere of supreme and universal perception, in which they can behold the true nature of the universe, but for this they must have attained the wisdom of Buddha himself. And it is not by the use of science or logic that we can expect to acquire such wisdom." More recently, the famous Sri Lankan monk Walpola Rahula has declared, quote, "To put on the same footing the Buddha and a philosopher or a scientist, however celebrated he may be, is a gross disrespect to the great teacher." Yet for most, the mere fact that scientific research has not yet offered significant insights into Buddhist thought and practice does not mean that it cannot. For the remainder of my comments this afternoon, I'd like to consider, albeit tentatively, some possible areas for exploration. In the field of developmental psychology, one thinks of the work of Susan Gelman on essentialism. She has shown that from a very young age, children in a wide range of cultures come to believe that the objects that constitute a particular category share an essence, a true nature, something that is not visible, but that nonetheless provides each member of that category with its own identity as well as its shared membership in the category. For any student of Buddhism, this immediately evokes the notion of svabhava, a Sanskrit term literally meaning own being, and variously translated as intrinsic nature, inherent existence, or essentialism. It is the claim of the Madhyamaka school of Indian Buddhist philosophy that all beings instinctively believe that all phenomena are endowed with some intrinsic nature, some essence that makes each object what it is, and that this perception of an essence is not only conceptual, but extends even to sense experience. Gelman seeks to understand why children see the world in this way, concluding that it is an evolutionary adaptation, one that has certain benefits for interacting with the objects of our experience. For the Buddhist, of course, the conception of intrinsic existence or essentialism is the most fundamental form of ignorance, and hence the root of all suffering. It is this belief in essences that must be destroyed in order to bring an end to suffering and rebirth. I won't pursue the particular parallels here further, but only add a note of caution. Even the most cursory survey of the discourse of Buddhism and science over the past century and a half reveals a series of moments of misrecognition, the philosophical equivalent of approaching a stranger on the street and saying, "You look so familiar. Have we met someplace before?" Put another way, the history of Buddhism and science is filled with false resonance. The doctrine of karma sounds like the theory of evolution. The account of the origin, the Buddhist account of the origin of the cosmos, sounds like the Big Bang. The doctrine of emptiness sounds like quantum physics. Immanuel Kant once observed that, quote, "Since human reason has been enraptured by innumerable objects in various ways for many centuries, it cannot easily fail that for everything new, something old can be found which has some kind of similarity to it." This is true enough, and it's also true that our minds make consistent use of comparison to organize experience. Like essentialism, comparison may well be an evolutionary adaptation, but in the case of Buddhism and science, something else seems also to be at work. Perhaps, like all religions, Buddhism is profoundly retrospective, looking to the past to understand the present in the hope of securing a haven safe from a hazardous future. The Buddha taught a path from a world of suffering to a state where there is no suffering, and it's said that he set forth that path only after following it himself. Thus, there is a comfort in the knowledge that the course to the safe haven has already been clearly charted. There is a comfort in the knowledge that that course has already been successfully navigated. There is a comfort in the knowledge that the other shore has already been reached. Science, in its popular representation, offers a different appeal, an appeal to the quest for what has never been known by anyone, and yet is somehow there, waiting to be discovered if we just knew how to find it. In the meantime, we must live in doubt of our deepest knowledge. And so perhaps this is why we yearn for the teachings of the Buddha, an itinerant mendicant of Iron Age India, to anticipate the formula of Einstein. And in this regard, the story of the history of Buddhism and science is different from the history of Christianity and science. For Christianity, science has often been represented as a challenge to Scripture, especially to the book of Genesis. That challenge has been powerful and persistent, and the relation between Christianity and science has, at least in its most visible forms, been one of antagonism. Why has it been different for Buddhism? It's important to note that there have been moments of antagonism, although they're long forgotten. In the first encounters of Buddhism and science in Asia, science was a weapon used by Christian missionaries against Buddhism, seeking to demonstrate errors in the Buddha's teaching. Thus, during a debate between a Methodist convert and a Buddhist monk in Sri Lanka in 1873, the Christian speaker asked why the central mountain at the center of the Buddhist universe, said to be 80,000 yojanas, or something like 500,000 miles high, had never been seen by anyone. According to one account, a Buddhist monk, presumably referring to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in the Garden of Eden, shouted from the crowd, "Climb to the top of that tall tree described in your sutras and you can see it." A somewhat more serious response was provided by the Methodist minister's interlocutor, the monk Gunananda, who responded with his own question asking why, if the central mountain located north of our continent does not exist, then why does the mariner's compass always point north? But these kinds of disputes over bare facts have occurred but rarely in the history of Buddhism and science. Any number of reasons for this might be put forward, from the storied malleability of Buddhism, so famous for adapting it easily to the cultural preconceptions of a given time or place, to the simple fact that Buddhism is far less deeply ingrained in the collective psyche of the West than Christianity. As discussed last week, Buddhism has so often served as a kind of safe surrogate for Christianity, avoiding all those problems of religion and science by being a religion that is also a science. And if it is to serve this purpose, science, whatever that word has meant over the past century and a half, must somehow be found in Buddhism. And so this must sound like that. This is not to suggest that such parallels do not exist, or that their pursuit is in every case unfruitful. It's rather that before such parallels are proclaimed, something of the long pattern of other parallels must be understood, and something of the psychology of the compulsion to compare must be acknowledged. Nor is this to suggest, in the slightest, that research on the neurology of meditation should not be conducted. The prevalence of meditation in Buddhism has long been overstated. The majority of Buddhists over the long history of the tradition have never meditated for a moment. But meditation is the virtuoso practice par excellence of the tradition of monks and nuns who've devoted themselves to its practice and other monks and nuns to its theory for more than two millennia. Clearly, something was occurring in their brains, regardless of how it was described, and it would be fascinating to know whether it could be somehow measured. Regardless of how far such neurological data might stray from the traditional instruction for meditation and the meditative states said to result from them, it would be a great loss should the rich vocabulary and imagery of Buddhist meditation somehow be abandoned. Still, there are many questions to be asked and answered, questions not simply that the ancient meditation practices of Buddhism might answer for modern neurology, but questions about Buddhist meditation that might be answered by neurology. Let me provide one example. Much of what we know about the left brain and right brain can be traced back to research done in the 1960s by Robert Sperry and William Gnaziga, working with a patient who, in an effort to stop severe epileptic seizures, had the corpus callosum, the bundle of nerves separating the two sides of the brain, surgically severed. The two neurologists designed a series of experiments in which images were displayed to each of the patient's visual fields, asking him to tap keys to indicate what he saw. The right eye and hand are connected to the left brain, and the left eye and hand connected to the right. The profound differences between the two hemispheres became clear when images were displayed to the left visual field, and hence the right brain. The patient claimed to have seen nothing, yet his left hand, under the control of the right brain, would tap the key each time an image appeared, as he'd been instructed to do. It seemed that the right brain had seen the image, but had been unable to name it. Subsequent experiments by these and other scientists led to the understanding that the right brain is superior to the left in dealing with the visual and the spatial, while the left brain is superior to the right in dealing with the linguistic and the discursive. As we know, numerous cliches and stereotypes have followed in the wake of this work. A subsequent experiment with another split-brain patient offered a more nuanced view. The patient was shown two pictures, each visible to one visual field and invisible to the other. The left hemisphere was shown a picture of a rooster's claw, and the right hemisphere was shown a snowscape. The patient was then shown four objects for each image and asked to select the one that matched the picture by pointing to the correct object. For the snow scene, the patient was shown a lawnmower, a rake, a snow shovel, and an axe. For the rooster's claw, the patient was shown an apple, a toaster, a hammer, and a rooster's head. The left brain, the logical side, correctly pointed to the rooster's head to go with the rooster's foot. And the right brain, the intuitive side, correctly pointed to the snow shovel to go with the winter scene. In each case, the two hemispheres made the correct association. The patient was then asked why the rooster's head and shovel were selected. The first answer was predictable. The rooster's head goes with the rooster's foot. The second answer was not. One would expect the patient to explain that you need the snow shovel to shovel snow. But he said, you need the shovel to clean out the chicken coop. That is, the right brain, the nonverbal brain, knew that the snow shovel goes with the snow, but could not articulate it, could not explain why. The left brain, which never saw the snow scene, but saw the left hand, which is connected to the right brain's choice of the shovel, did something creative. It produced a narrative. one that is logical under the circumstances, but that is utterly at odds with reality. The left brain seemed compelled to provide the anomalous object with meaning. There are a number of ways to interpret this story. Perhaps the most cynical of these would be that the stories that we tell to explain the world, from the founding myths of the world religions to doctoral dissertations, at least in the humanities, are in the end just so much chicken shit, with all our efforts at profound analysis just so much shoveling. A somewhat more nuanced reading of the experiment would consider its implications for such perennial questions in the history of philosophy as the role of language in perception and the relation of sense perception and thought, questions that are equally central to Buddhist philosophy. Within the domain of Buddhism and science, the experiment provides a possibly useful perspective on the relation between meditation and doctrine. One of the fundamental tropes of Buddhism is that everything that the Buddha taught, and he's said to have taught 84,000 doctrines, is in some sense the enunciation of his silent experience, seated cross-legged in meditation beneath a tree on that moonlit night. The subsequent elaboration of those doctrines in treatises composed across the Buddhist world, treatises composed in Sanskrit, Pali, Chinese, Japanese, Tibetan, Korean, Thai, that elaboration is but commentary on the Buddha's words and hence upon his enlightenment. Thus, there is a profound retrospection to the tradition as a huge network of texts in many languages all trace their roots back to a single and silent source. This silence comes into play in the sutras. A text entitled the Sutra, setting forth the inconceivable secrets of the Tathagata, declares, quote, "From the night when the Tathagata fully awakened in unsurpassed, complete, perfect enlightenment, until the night when he passed without remainder into final nirvana, the Tathagata, the Buddha, did not utter a single syllable." Another silence descends from another source. As scholars of Buddhism, that is, scholars who used to be called Orientalists, have for over a century and a half sought to determine what the Buddha taught. Like Jesus, the Buddha did not write anything. His words were remembered by monks and nuns, even acknowledging the storied mnemonics of ancient Indian religions. The quest for his true words is complicated by the fact that nothing seems to have been written down until the last decades before the Common Era, and then not in India, but in Sri Lanka. And the extant versions of what is accepted by the tradition as Buddha Vachana, the speech of the Buddha, derive from Sri Lankan editions from the 5th century CE, at least 8 centuries after the Buddha's death. Some scholars continue to think that the Buddha's original teachings can be reconstructed. Others consider his words unrecoverable, but both look back to a certain silence. This silence has led to a focus on, some would say, a fetishization of experience. In the field of religious studies, there has been a considerable debate on the relative priority of mystical experience and doctrine, on whether doctrine is somehow the articulation of mystical experience, or whether that experience is both induced and defined by doctrine. In the discourse of Buddhism and science, there has been almost universal support for the priority of experience, stemming in part from the Victorian view of the scientific Buddha as a man who gained enlightenment through his own silent reflections and not through divine revelation. The Buddha's mind is thus portrayed as a laboratory where hypotheses are tested and rejected, arriving finally at the truth which the Buddha then articulated. Leaving aside the question of how the Buddha's brain might be different from ours, what might the rooster's claw have to do with the question of the relation between doctrine and experience, in this case, the experience of meditation? If it is the case, as research has suggested, that only about 2% of the information that the brain takes in each minute is processed consciously, with the other 98% processed by the unconscious brain, what are the mechanisms that allow the unconscious to become conscious? What are the mechanisms that allow the conscious to penetrate into the unconscious? In the case of meditation, how does silent experience become verbalized? These are profound questions in the history of philosophy, made all the more difficult by problems of translation, where terms like conscious and unconscious have no immediate correlates in the extensive Buddhist vocabulary of mental states. If these questions are considered from the perspective of the rooster's claw, what confidence do we have that the narrative deriving from the experience, whatever that term might mean, accurately reflects that experience? If doctrine derives from experience, then the experiment suggests that doctrine is at best epiphenomenal. In the course of neurological research, one would expect that the deepest states of Buddhist experience will eventually be identified as the firing of neurons in a specific area of the brain. What is the relation of this experience to its classical description found in the Buddhist canon? The massive edifice of Buddhist doctrine would seem in some sense an afterthought, an inadequate and in some sense irrelevant attempt to articulate what the brain has already understood on an unconscious level, an understanding that cannot be spoken. In order to consider this question, one would need to identify whether meditation is a right brain, that is, intuitive, or left brain, that is, rational activity. Any survey of the standard meditation manuals would suggest that it is both. For example, there's a traditional division into analytical meditation and stabilizing meditation. Analytical meditation would include reasoned reflection on the absence of self among the physical and mental constituents of the person. Stabilizing meditation would include the various techniques for quieting thought and focusing one pointedly on a given object. How might these categories be mapped onto the neurobiological categories of analysis and insight? Here, in the laboratory, analysis is defined as a methodological search for a solution to a problem, and it is a process located in the left brain. Insight is defined as breaking through an impasse with affects of both surprise and certainty. Insight's been located in the right brain. Experiments have shown that such insight is inhibited by both verbalization and concentration. Insights occur at unexpected moments, especially during states of drowsiness after waking from a night's sleep. When anyone interested in Buddhism hears the word insight, she or he thinks immediately of the Pali term vipassana, translated as insight and the name of one of the most popular forms of Buddhist meditation in the West. And didn't the Buddha become enlightened after meditating all night? He must have been drowsy. In unexpected moments, that sounds like Zen. But again, caution is called for. In Buddhist literature, insight is not exactly spontaneous, and its knowledge is not exactly unexpected. Unlike arriving at a new scientific discovery, one thinks of the famous story of Kekule's vision of the snake biting its own tail when he discovered the benzene ring. Buddhist insight involves arriving at an understanding that many others have gained in the past, and furthermore, an understanding that one has already arrived at intellectually. Yet, it must also be said that much Buddhist literature is suspicious of the intellect, seeing it as a tool to be used and then abandoned. Describing the use of analysis in the cultivation of wisdom, the Kashyapa Chapter Sutra says, Kashyapa, it is thus. For example, fire arises when the wind rubs two branches together. Once the fire has started, the two branches are burned. Just so, Kashyapa, if you possess the correct analytical intellect, noble wisdom is created. Through its creation, the analytical intellect is consumed. And it's said that the Buddha had no thought, only direct perception, without the medium of mental images. So it seems as if the goal is the silent intuition associated with the right brain, and yet the Buddha speaks. Like the Buddha's original teachings, the neurology of the Buddha's enlightenment is probably irretrievable. And thus the question of the origin of doctrine remains in the domain of myth. But Buddhist monks and nuns have meditated for millennia and have done so based on discursive instructions, a discourse that has long claimed to result in the deepest states of awareness of which the human mind is capable. If there is to be a dialogue between Buddhism and science, it will come in the form of translation, an activity central to the spread of the Dharma over the centuries and across the realms. Here, the translation will not be the translation of the four levels of the formless realm into levels of blood pressure. But in the more challenging translation of doctrine into meditative states and meditative states into scientific data. As this fall's Terry lectures draw to a close, what can we say about the scientific Buddha? First, he's a young Buddha, born in the 19th century, not in the royal city of Kapilavastu, but in the republican city of Paris. From there, he traveled to Sri Lanka and then to other parts of Asia. A century and a half after his birth, he is alive and well in the imaginations of many around the world. As I've tried to show, this scientific Buddha is a pale reflection of the Buddha born in Asia, a Buddha who entered our world in order to destroy it. This Buddha had no interest in being compatible with science. The relation of Buddhism and science, then, should not be seen as a disagreement over when and how the universe began. It should not be seen as, in Stephen Jay Gould's memorable phrase, non-overlapping magisteria with science concerned with fact and religion concerned with morality. It should not be seen in Buddhist terms as the two truths, with science concerned with the conventional truth and Buddhism concerned with the ultimate truth. Buddhism and science each has its own narrative and its own telos. If an ancient religion like Buddhism has anything to offer science, it is not in the facile confirmation of its findings. If the past has a future, it is in the description of an alternative world, one that calls into question so many of the fundamental assumptions of our scientific world. A Tibetan poet wrote these lines about the Buddha. To the sharp weapons of the demons, you offer delicate flowers in return. When the enraged Devadatta pushed down a boulder, you practice silence. Son of the Shakyas, incapable of casting even an angry glance at your enemy, what intelligent person would honor you as a protector from fearful samsara? To the sharp weapons of the demons, you offer delicate flowers in return. This line refers to the story of the Buddha's enlightenment, when Mara, the god of desire and death, dispatched his army of demons against the Buddha, attacking him with a hail of weapons. The Buddha transformed their hail of spears and arrows into a gentle rain of flowers. When the enraged Devadatta pushed down a boulder, you practice silence. This refers to the Buddha's evil cousin, Devadatta, who, seeking to succeed the Buddha as head of the order of monks and nuns, tried to assassinate the Buddha by pushing down a boulder to crush him. The boulder only nicked the Buddha's toe, making a small cut. By his act, however, Devadatta committed two of the deeds that result in immediate rebirth in hell, causing blood to flow from the Buddha and causing dissent in the monastic community. But in neither attack did the Buddha retaliate. Son of the Shakyas, incapable of casting even an angry glance at your enemy, what intelligent person would honor you as a protector from fearful samsara? A Buddhist is someone who seeks refuge from suffering in the three jewels, the Buddha, the Dharma, that is, his teaching, and the Sangha, the community of the enlightened. Here the poet asks, if this is how the Buddha responded to attacks on his own person, what intelligent person, the Tibetan word is loden, perhaps translated better as what person in his or her right mind, would look to the Buddha for protection from the myriad sufferings of samsara, the Buddha who would not even defend himself? The poet's suggestion is that the purpose of the Buddha's path is to overturn the ordinary. The poet's implication is that being in one's right mind may have been the problem all along. Thus, the Buddha does the opposite of what the world would counsel. Setting aside his own welfare in lifetime after lifetime, constantly resisting the demands of self, declaring, in fact, that there is no self, compassionately leading all beings to their own extinction. And as a result of his resistance to what the world regards as wisdom, the Buddha achieved the ultimate state of perfection. The 8th century poet Shantideva wrote of the Buddha, What need is there to say more? The childish act for their own welfare. The sage acts for the welfare of others. Behold the difference between them. Thank you.
Never let it be said that you don't have a sense of narrative, that you've brought it all to a resounding climax today. I'm kind of overwhelmed. It was really wonderful. I would like to ask, part of what the context of what I brought up yesterday about the middle way, ostensibly refuting some of the ideas of the Nikaya school, can be seen in the context of the two truths. You know, and I acknowledge your point, that is the way that I took it was that they're not simply refuting, that we do have conventional reality, and if you don't pay attention to it, you'll get run over by a truck. But that there is an absolute reality, and it's the apprehension of that absolute reality.
Actually, the ultimate truth is emptiness itself. The apprehension of it is a conventional truth. It's a consciousness. Yeah.
That's a good point. but that apprehension is a central piece of the path out of suffering.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so you made a remark about how science and Buddhism should not be set up this way in terms of this duality of the...
Right.
The two truths. I'd like if you could unpack that a bit.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, again, it's important to remember that, at least in the Madhyamaka school, as I understand it, the ultimate truth is only emptiness. It's only this absence of intrinsic nature. And so everything else is a conventional truth, including the Buddha himself. And so, of course, most of the things that Buddhism talks about from that perspective are conventional truths and are not to be left to science. They're too important from one perspective, right? The Dalai Lama has made a different distinction, which I think is quite interesting, which he says that let's look at in terms of the Four Noble Truths, that the first two truths of suffering and the origin of suffering can be, that's where we can get some help from science. And the last two truths, cessation and path, that's the domain of Buddhism. But I was trying to complicate even that claim a little bit today by talking about what is meant by suffering, and that the sufferings that are thus far identified by medical science, for example, are all of on the most superficial level from the Buddhist perspective, and they're much more profound forms of suffering that are central to the understanding of the path.
I am shy, but anyway, here I am. I kind of, I don't know, I have the 100,000 things to ask, but here's a couple, in a way. Well, Buddha was kind of promoting not his way, but try it your own way, was he not? Don't take my word for, like, how I did it, but, like, you know, find your own way, your own path. Did he
not?
Yeah,
that's often said, although the part of those quotations that usually left out is that you'll find out that my way is right.
Okay, I'm finding out.
Right.
And I'd like to hear something about, this kind of sticks in my head, I don't really know what it means, but that emptiness is emptiness, form is emptiness, emptiness
yeah,
is
yeah.
emptiness, and form
right.
is form. And
yeah.
A little bit on that, please.
Okay. So you're quoting the Heart Sutra, a very famous Mahayana text that says that form is emptiness and emptiness is form. This is exactly the point we're talking about earlier, the relation between the ultimate and conventional. And there are many, many interpretations of that single line. I wrote a whole book about that. But one of those interpretations is that the final nature of the forms of our experience is this emptiness. And emptiness as reality is not to be found apart from the ordinary object of our experience. Emptiness means the lack of intrinsic nature. It's this essentialism we were talking about earlier today. Of essence, empty of essence, yeah, right.
So did I make up those other lines about the form of emptiness and emptiness as form? Is that part of it? Or
yeah, those are right. The last two are not in the sutra. Yeah, right. Yeah, okay, right.
I guess in Nagarjuna, in the Muloma Jamaka Karaka, I forget the chapter number, maybe 24, it's the, he states the need to distinguish ultimate and relative truth, the need to keep them, to establish the distinction. But there are certain schools of Buddhism which have seen it necessary to somehow provide a link. I'm thinking of say Mipam Rinpoche, or perhaps even Chantarakshita, depending on how you interpret him. And that was done through this concept of sapariyaya, qualified ultimate truth. It's a mm-hmm. kind of truth that you can name,
right.
Or that you can... And can you understand the sort of scientific... scientific Buddhism is somehow an effort to create a qualified... ultimate truth, somehow a way to provide confidence, to encourage people on the path that somehow puts people in the orientational, though it is nowhere near ultimate truth, nowhere near what perhaps is experienced through deepest meditation or even through deepest conceptual pondering.
Mm-hmm. And how does science work in? I don't see the science connection there.
Well, through somehow providing a referent through states which are beyond conception, through some kind of neuronic activity.
Some kind of what?
Synaptic activity.
Yeah, I think we don't know the answer to that. I really see the neurobiological research and meditation as the next big thing in Buddhism and science. As I've tried to show, for the most part, this has been a kind of comforting claim. Which also has an element of Buddhist triumphalism to it, frankly, that it's the most scientific, most modern of religions. There are all sorts of historical reasons for saying that. And the problem that we always have to keep in mind is that we're also living in a historical moment, and 100 years from now, there'll be somebody like me who's written a book or whatever books are at that time who are saying, well, back in the first decade of the 21st century, they thought meditation was the thing. And so we can already see five or six different stages, beginning with the quack science of theosophy, going through magnetism, through a mechanistic universe. All of these have somehow been Buddhist. Now we're at the point where we're looking at meditation, which, as I tried to note, is different somehow, because there seems to be something testable, something falsifiable in one way or another. And I think it's too early to say. So I'd rather leave it just at that.
Thank you. Yeah.
I guess you accuse the Buddhists, or you describe the Buddhists as always looking back, and science looks forward. So I fall into that looking back category. So I wanted to ask you if you would agree with this formulation, which is Vachaspati Mishra's commentary to the Sankhya Sutra. And he starts out, why do we need this? In other words, why do we need religion? And he says that there's suffering, and everyone agrees to that. But then some people say, well, you can take medicines. There are other ways to alleviate mm-hmm. suffering. And he says, that's not the suffering I'm talking about. So he carves out a sphere that is distinctive for religion and that other things are just can't touch. Would you agree with that conclusion?
Well, I wanted to say that there are levels of suffering that seem to have been only identified by the Buddha. Whether they're suffering or not is part of a larger doctrinal system and a claim to be analyzed. But certainly there is something there which is not going to be touched by, as I said, indoor plumbing or good dental hygiene.
So in other words, I guess it's another formulation of this fact that there's the world out there and how you manipulate it, and then there's a really very separate sphere for religion.
I think so, but I don't want to call them the noma, the non-overlapping magisteria that Gold used. I think there are problems with that. Yeah.
May I ask how you became involved in Buddhism and what effect it's had on your life?
As I was saying at lunch today, I was asked a similar question. I don't have a good story. I need to make something up. It was simply the vulgar curiosity of an undergraduate who took a course on Chinese intellectual history and heard the word Buddhism and Bodhisattva, obviously triggered some deep karmic connection, which led me to study Buddhism. And then once one starts learning these languages, there's no career path open to you other than become an academic. So you're sort of stuck. It's obviously what I've devoted my life to, and so far so good. Yeah. Any other questions like that, we'll have to turn off the podcast, okay? Sorry.
I have a question that's informational or for clarification. You talked yesterday about consciousness or an entity that has sort of infinite past lives and goes on until extinction.
Right.
And in other lectures and today, you talked about the unreality of the self from a Buddhist point of view.
Right.
And I wonder if you could clarify what the difference is between the self and this entity that has so many lives.
Right. Well, the difference, doctrinally speaking, is that consciousness only lasts for a moment before producing another moment of consciousness. And so it's entirely momentary. Although it's impermanent in that sense, it's not chaotic. And thus, your continuum of consciousness is different from mine. Yours carries all of your past deeds. Mine carries mine. They never get mixed up. So there's an orderliness to this impermanent process. Self would be a moment of consciousness that lasts longer than one moment. And the Buddhists want to claim that there's nothing within the mind or body that lasts longer than that. And that to say that there is some kind of an owner, a possessor, kind of permanent soul or self, this is the great problem, the great mistake that causes all false suffering. So
is it misleading then to talk about this stream of consciousness, so to speak?
Yeah.
Is it misleading then to talk about this stream of consciousness or this chain of transitory moments, an entity? Or is it the chain you're talking about?
Really more about the chain. I mean, it depends on what, when you say entity, I then have to think, what term would that be, in Sanskrit or Tibetan? It certainly does exist, but it's impermanent. It's just going like that. And so there's nothing that lasts longer than an instant. And that's what they always point to, is this subtle impermanence, even of that thing which carries all of our experiences from lifetime to lifetime.
Self would be a structure or something enduring.
Exactly. And enduring, again, longer than one instant. And they want to say that there's nothing here that lasts longer than this. Yeah. The Buddhists say that, yeah, right. Yeah.
I wanted to thank you for this really very beautifully crafted and very learned series of lectures. It's been a very stimulating and thinking kind of experience. After the lectures, I'm left with this sort of a big question. And that is, for the most part, I felt as I listened to your lectures, that you're sort of saying that Buddhism and science don't have much to do with each other. They are two different things. Right. Now, I think you're saying something a little bit different in the last two lectures, maybe especially today. And I just wondered, I could see that you're saying that science might help us understand Buddhism.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you're saying that.
Yeah.
Now, you also said that Dalai Lama thinks that Buddhism sort of is a future science.
Right.
Because if science gets better, they understand Buddhism. In other words, Buddhism has a lot to offer eventually to science. I didn't hear you take that step.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wondered whether you take that step or you hesitate.
I hesitate on that one.
Why? Yeah. And so on. I just wondered.
So, as I said yesterday, the Dalai Lama feels that both karma and rebirth will eventually be proved by science. I have to remain agnostic on that. And again, we have this question of this tradition being so ancient. You know, it's Iron Age India. You know, as we were talking yesterday in the reception, let's just throw it all out. This is just some anachronism, right? This is some old thing. We can study it. That's fine. It's a topic of discussion. We can have courses about it, books about it. But why would we ever imagine that it has anything to say to us today? It's so incommensurable with our life. Well, let's just put it in the museum. But then, you know, you read something like the Buddha saying that humans have eight forms of suffering, right? Birth, aging, sickness, death, right? Losing friends, gaining enemies, not getting what you want, getting what you don't want. That's pretty much my life. And the fact that it was said long ago in a strange language, there's still something about that that has continued to mean something. And so I guess I'm trying to both figure out how much of that remains of some use, whatever use might mean, and then how one goes about making that decision. So it's not so much that I think that something that the Buddha said is going to help scientists. I don't even know what that would mean in a sense. But I do think that the meditation research is one interesting, you know, possibly fruitful angle, because we know that it's a historical fact that Buddhists have meditated for a long time. And there had to be something about it that was fun, or they wouldn't have done it. I mean, there had to be something. I mean, we know the posture is very uncomfortable. We've all, you know, everybody who's tried to sit down in the lotus posture, you know that that's not pleasant, at least the first 100 times you try. And so what was going on in their brains? And how does that experience, whatever that is, relate to what we see in text? That's a fascinating question to me, this doctrine versus experience thing. And I think that science might provide some way of understanding that question. That's the one that I'm sort of most interested in right now. You have to go back to the microphone.
Well, are you having fun? Do you want to be here? Are you here at all?
What'd you say?
Are you having fun?
Yes.
Are you here now?
Yeah.
And you want to be here now?
Definitely. Yeah.
Beautiful.
Okay.
Me too.
Okay. Yeah.
So.
It's on.
Professor, I was a little bit surprised that, and this week it seems that religion has revived in this campus, because we know that Habermas also at the same time is giving a talk on the revival of religion, and of course I'm interested in Buddhism, so I came here, and since you talked about a little bit about Chinese history, I just want to ask a question about China. We know that in recent years, many Chinese people, they were, you know, before that, many generation, young generations like me, we were atheists.
Mm-hmm.
And now many of us were searching sort of spiritual self-help, from religions like mm-hmm. Buddhism and mm-hmm. Christianity,
right?
And it was estimated that the Christians in China now has been about 100 million, and we know that China traditionally was a country where Buddhism was prevailing.
Yeah.
So, for generally speaking, for Chinese, Christianity is sort of more positive, more proactive, and Buddhism is more passive, which means that Christianity w- would presume that there is a goal or intrinsic meaning of reality, of personal life. But in Buddhism, there's no meaning at all. So I'm just wondering how you view about this comparison between Christianity and Buddhism.
Well, I don't think that the Buddhism would say there's no meaning at all. It certainly has been called life-denying and rejected in many times in the history of China. But we know that Buddhist monasteries are beginning to flourish all over China. And 50 years of atheism is not enough to sort of kill a great tradition like that. The rise of Christianity is fascinating as well. It's not something I've been following or know that much about, so I can't offer any intelligent comment, I'm sorry to say.
Thank you, Professor Lopez, for the great lecture. My question is, I found sometimes in history, the Buddhism and science was not conflicting. For example, the great monk Yixing in China was also a great scientist. And this made me think of esoteric Buddhism in particular. I know nothing about modern science, but as you described science yesterday, the science meant to help people live longer, live healthier, the esoteric Buddhism also did so.
So does Taoism, right? Yeah.
Right, but it has been thought as a corrupted kind of Buddhism always, usually, right? So do you think esoteric Buddhism can provide a particular way to relate science and Buddhism right now, or you still think it's corrupted?
Well, I don't think those are the two alternatives. I don't think of esoteric Buddhism as corrupted, obviously. But I think one of the things I probably should have said at the beginning of these lectures is that by science, in these lectures, I mean the Western tradition that was introduced into Asia during the colonial period. So whether we want to, there are many forms of ancient Indian science and Chinese science, all those things are there. And Buddhism's relation to those is an entirely different question. The ways in which Buddhist monks were often healers and they brought various medicinal techniques to courts and spread Buddhism that way. That's an entirely different subject, different book, different sanitary lectures. What you're raising is a very important point. What is traditional science versus modern science in the Buddhist case? But my entire thesis here has been about this Western science and the Buddhist appropriation of that term for various purposes over the past 150 years. Yeah. Thank you.
It seems that...
To get a little bit closer to...
A growing number of practitioners in the West seem to have come to Buddhism first as an intellectual practice and secondarily as a practice, and many also kind of either reject or have difficulty with elements of the doctrine of reincarnation.
Right.
So I was wondering your particular views on whether one should take it more metaphorically or in a strict literal context, as some more traditional schools would, and whether you think that accepting or rejecting it, or how you think accepting or rejecting the doctrine of reincarnation as in a more literal context plays into the legitimacy of Buddhism in the West.
I'm a strict literalist on that point. The Buddhists over the centuries have believed that there are hells and there are heavens, and they've spent a lot of time and effort to get to the heavens and to avoid the hells. I remember Tibetan Lama being asked the very question that you asked, that is, can you be a Buddhist if you don't believe in rebirth? And he said, why would you? Why would you, you know, take so much time to meditate and study all these things when you're going to die pretty soon anyway? Well, if there's no future lifetime, there's no reason to put yourself through all this trouble. And so he said, if there's only one lifetime, just go out and enjoy yourself. Don't worry about the next lifetime because it doesn't exist, and forget about Buddhism. So that would be the traditional answer, and I generally go along with that, the whole metaphoric reading of the hells and so forth as dream states or deep depression. That's a problem for me. Yeah.
Yes, I would appreciate just more clarification on something you were speaking about today, the relation of doctrine to experience.
Yeah.
I guess you meant the experience of meditation.
Right.
When you spoke of the split brain and left, right, and the function of narrative in those split brain experiments,
right.
I was getting the impression that you were pretty much saying, well, whatever legitimacy or meaning experience may have, Buddhist experience may have, the doctrine is something which is just a made-up story, and we can pretty much put it aside.
That's a possible reading of that experiment. Yeah, I raised that as a possibility, but if that's the case, it's a little sad. So I'm hoping that that's not the case, right? But it's one way to read the experiment. Yeah.
That wasn't your thesis. You were not defending that as.
No, I was raising it as one reading of the experiment,
right.
but I hope not the final word. Yeah. Yes, sir.
I've just been thinking a lot about Bob Sharpe's critique of the category experience.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I'm just wondering, you seem to be quite, at least cautiously enthusiastic about the scientific study of the meditative experience. And I was just wondering, as a scholar of religion, given this critique, I mean, I guess we're the only ones that are uncomfortable with the category of experience. Science and
right.
Buddhism seem to be
right.
quite...
Sure.
Gung-ho about it. So I was just wondering how, if you could answer that question as a scholar of religion, how that makes you feel.
What question is that?
Just like the critique of, I mean, I'm just seeing a kind of, what do you think the implications are for religious studies, which has kind of jettisoned or bracketed this category of experience as being something problematic?
Right. I mean, so the earliest, you know, the work, some of the work done by Stephen Katz and others is really about making the claim that doctrine produces experience. The doctrine comes first. Whatever that experience might be, it's programmed somehow by doctrine. There are others, as you know, more on the sort of Buddhist side of things, who would want to say that experience comes first and doctrine is merely the articulation of the Buddha's experience. And then what experience means at all is, of course, a huge issue, but it is the case that something happens in the brain when someone sits down to meditate. That will, at some point or another, be measurable, whatever that means. And so we have to then think about what's appearing on some screen, what a person is saying they're experiencing, and what a text would say. And so it's the translation among those three that I think is the interesting domain for research, and not simply by scientists, but by Buddhologists and by students of religion. It's a very strange, many, many possibilities exist among those three, certainly, and I think the exploration of those possibilities is possibly fruitful, put it that way.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.